Well, surprisingly so. They tend to, again, this goes back to the idea of space and scale as being central to caribou. The kinds of responses we see are often on the order of kilometers. And so a caribou will distance themselves away from roads, away from mine sites, for example, not on the order of a few hundreds of meters, but often on the scale of 5 to 10 kilometers. And so that's the kind of planning that we need to put into place. We have the foresight to do it. We simply need to change our structures, change our what we consider to be long-term planning to be in line with how caribou respond to the landscape.
Just as a final thought, then, Professor Schaefer, what would happen if, given the pressures of society and so on, many years down the road, say a couple of decades or so, industrial development is seen as a priority and the caribou less so because humankind needs resources, I suppose. What do we lose as a human species if we start to lose the caribou?
Well, I think we can answer that on a couple of levels. One is simply ethical. So we can look back and we know that human survival depended on caribou for many millennia. Look back to Europe, for example, 35,000 years ago. Caribou was the species that allowed for the emergence of modern humans at that time. Some of the middens, some of the archaeological sites we see are almost 100% caribou. So caribou were important for human survival, and that was true right up to the 20th century, when the George River caribou herd declined, Innu people starved. And so this has been true for a long time that humans have depended on caribou. Of course, now those roles are reversed, and caribou depend now on our decisions. I think it's important that we simply at least ask ourselves, what kind of future do we want in that regard? And the other is ecological, of course, as well, is that caribou can be seen as an indicator species for the connectivity, for example, of a landscape, which is very important for other species. So we can use caribou as a guide. I really think this is caribou century, the 21st century. It will be the indicator of our success and our ability to find that balance.
Professor Schaefer, thanks very much for talking to us today.
Been my pleasure.
And that was my conversation with Jim Schaefer, a professor in the Department of Biology at Trent University. And we'll link to his website from our own page, which is rcinet.ca/the link. And Professor Schaefer joined us on the line from Peterborough, Ontario. Well, now from Frontenac County, Ontario, this is Terry Tufts and a tune called Never No More.
I wandered down to water's edge, down to the churning sea. I called out to the ship of state, but they would not hear me. I begged for guidance o'er the waves, I gave my trust in vain. Never no more, never no more, never no more again. I passed my sister's house and home, I found her there in tears. She'd hoped for more than rhetoric to help her through her fears. Her status choked, her spirit broke for want of equal wage. But never no more, never no more, never no more again. I walked up to my neighbor's farm, his life and love he claimed. When imports undercut by half, I heard my neighbor say, they told of better days ahead, the bastards lied again. Never no more. never no more, never no more again. We faltered not at Chrysler's farm, held ground at Lundy's Lane. And how brave tars fought bold and hard in the North Atlantic fray. And now they think we have no fight, no pride, no hope, no shame. Never no more, never no more, never no more again.
And you have music from Frontenac County, Terry Tuff's Never No More. Kind of an appropriate song when you think that Canada is celebrating the 200th anniversary of the War of 1812 this year. So there's a little bit of a historical bent to that particular song. Well, it's time now for the CBC Budget Choir.
It's Terry Hay.
Yes, indeed. That was me on the organ, by the way, Terry.
You're an amazing guy.
I know. It's
no doubt about it.
Yes, it's time for the Terry Haig Hour, shortened to about 5 minutes because of budget cuts, but there you go.
Well, there are some people on the way up, Montgomery, unlike us, the young hockey players of the world.
Oh?
It is the draft tonight. Okay.
That's why I had to close my collar, because there was a draft in here.
Come on, Montgomery. It's the last show.
Oh,
you've got to do
late.
Better than
I
that.
Know. I'm Jeez. Sorry. Right. Where's the rim shots?
Russian forward Nahil Yakupov. You never know with savants. When you pronounce the Russian names. But anyway, he's projected to go first. Now, Edmonton has the first crack. Tambellini, their GM, is leaning toward keeping his first overall pick. He said he hasn't got any out-of-this-world offers. So it looks like old Nahil will be in Edmonton for the winter.
Nahil?
Next winter.
Nahil?
Yeah, N-A-I-L.
Okay.
Okay. Excuse me, darling, I've got to do my Nahils. Okay. okay, so anyway, Columbus picks second, Montreal picks third, followed by the the Islanders and Toronto, Winnipeg ninth, Calgary 14th, Ottawa 15th, Vancouver 26th.
26th? My goodness.
Well, because the better the team, the way it works in reverse order.
Yeah. I knew that part. I just, you know.
We're going to go with it. Maybe we should go with a Formula One story just for old time's sake. But first, let me tell you about baseball.
Oh, of course.
Your favorite sport.
Hey, they got a guy cheating, didn't they?
I'm going to get to that.
Oh, you are?
Well, cheating.
Well, it was his warm-up glove, he said.
It was his warm-up glove. Okay, he had a bad week. His name is Joel Peralta, and he pitches for Tampa Bay.
Not that game, he didn't.
No. On Tuesday, he was caught with pine tar in his glove.
Now, explain what that would do to a pitcher.
You could put anything. Whatever you put on a ball, you can make it do all sorts of crazy things.
Oddball things, right?
Oddball things.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So they caught him, all right? But he said, he 8-game suspension, but he's protesting it or challenging it. So he pitched last night, served up a tie-breaking RBI double in the sixth to send the Washington Nationals, our old team, over the Rays 5-2. Now, I started to tell you before
Until
I was
you were
interrupted.
So rudely
that's
interrupted,
right.
Yes.
Rusty Staub, Real Cormier, Doug Melvin, and the members of the Equipe Nationale Senior 2011 are going into the Canadian Baseball Hall of Fame. Rusty Staub was the first star we had here before you were born.
You're talking Expos
in Montreal,
right?
Yeah. Expos. Okay, and Real Cormier was this great guy from Moncton. You know how he learned to pitch? He was so broke that he used to throw rocks at his mailbox. He's a lefty, a little lefty reliever, lasted 16 years in the majors. True story.
Well, you could probably sell that mailbox on eBay now for a fortune.
Ryder Hestedahl sold his pink jersey for winning the Giro d'Italia for $10,000. It's all going to charity.
Well, at least it's going to charity. That's
why are we segueing? I mean, what a team.
Oh, my God.
Segue, you bring up the subject. but imagine, he was so poor that he learned to pitch by throwing rocks at his mailbox. Then he got himself a scholarship to down to a school down in Rhode Island, a junior college. His brother was a second baseman. They went down there, and he pitched 16 years in the majors. I don't think he lives in Moncton anymore. I believe he lives in Florida. Yeah. Pitched for the Phillies for years.
Yes, I'm sure he holds the records for skipping stones across water, too. Could you just imagine a guy like that?
Is there water in Moncton?
Well, just a river there.
There is?
Yeah.
What river would that be? The Moncton River? Do they call it the Moncton River?
There's water nearby, you know.
There's water everywhere in Canada.
A pond will do.
Okay,
He's probably got a rock that skipped like 33 times or something in it.
Just probably did. Well, but it's lefty, so that the rocks aren't used to having a left being thrown by a lefty. There's a different spin on the ball.
Well, it depends whether you're in the northern hemisphere or southern
hemisphere. Exactly. if he lived in Brazil, he'd be fantastic.
Oh, there you go.
But I mean, the elements are working against him. Rusty Staub, the only guy to ever have 500 hits with four teams.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Doug Melvin, he's a pretty good general manager, and I have no idea what Le Monde d'Equipe Nationale Senior de 111. What they were.
Probably
they were going into the Hall of Fame.
They might have been the managers or something, officials. The guys who sat up in the box with the luxury food there.
No.
Oh, okay.
The team guys. The guys, the first baseman, the second baseman.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
All right. Now, guess what? Two of the biggest names in Canadian Olympic team history will compete in the road cycling competition in the London Games.
Okay.
Okay. Ryder Hesjedal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And guess who? Clara Hughes from out in the Eastern Townships.
Oh, right.
Okay.
She's one of those people who...
she's amazing.
Transitioned from being a skating star to a cycling star.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah, well, she does both now, and she's amazing. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, and then the two other members, Joelle Neumainville of Montreal and Denise Ramsden of Yellowknife Northwest Territories.
Mm-hmm.
They say biking makes strange bedfellows. Somebody from Montreal and... Okay, we're just about out of time. Montgomery, I just want to tell you something.
You do?
I do. Besides hating your guts, I got to say, I think that you guys, for the last 5 or 6 years, you and Levon and the rest of this team did an absolutely fabulous job. And the way I know that, not only from listening, but I do the Maple Leaf mailbag. I've gotten all these letters from everybody. It's a serious, serious loss to Canada to lose the link. You know, and I'm not going overboard. It was a great show. Chapeau. And to Suzanne Sugar as well.
But filling in for
Levon is a great journalist. I told him this to his face, so I won't embarrass him. He's a great journalist and a greater guy. And the fact what he put together here was absolutely fab. And what you did with it, Montgomery, was damn good, okay? And I just want to thank you for being so generous with me, putting up with me, and so generous with the audience. And to the audience, I want to say, man, you guys are absolutely fabulous. Generous of spirit, intelligent. And it's been a whole thing about radio. It's immediate. It's a dynamic, a dialectic that goes on between the audience and the radio. And this was as good as it gets. And I just want to thank everybody, all of you out there, and to Levon, and to you, and to Suzanne, and to everybody. Thank you, guys. Bless you.
And Terry, it's been more than a pleasure. It's been a wonderful experience having you on the show. Been a fabulous person to fill in for Ian Jones, and everybody appreciates it. So thank you very much as well.
Way to go, Mark. Bless you, man.
Hi, I'm Don Ferguson. You're listening to The Link with Mark Montgomery on RCI and CBC Radio 1, the former Canadian Radio Broadcasting Commission.
Whatever. Well, now...